Then I would like to introduce Henk ten Haven. And I would like to ask who didn't grow up with it. And then I mean the widely used book Medical Ethics or Medische Ethiek. And I think with this book you put medical ethics education, you put it on the map and helped to professionalize it. So we are very pleased that you are willing to talk on this symposium. You studied medicine and philosophy and worked in the University of Maastricht and Nijmegen and as a director of the Division of Ethics of Science and Technology of UNESCO in Paris. You retired in 2019 as professor of healthcare ethics in the Center of Healthcare Ethics at, Duquesne University in Pittsburgh in the US. And since 2021, he's a research professor at the Faculty of Bioethics, Anahuac University in Mexico. So quite international. And I think you know a lot about ethics education worldwide. So thank you for coming.
Yeah, thank you very much. I first of all would like to... First of all, I would like to thank Mariette for the invitation to speak at this symposium, because you asked me to talk about the global perspective, which is, of course, much broader than most of the presentations we have heard today. But I hope it will provide you with some background of your own work in a more specialized area. So the question is, if we talk about a global perspective, I would like to briefly address three specific questions. Why do we need a global perspective in the first place? Because that's not obvious anymore now that many people are critical about globalization and global perspectives. So why do we need a global perspective in ethics education? And what can such a perspective bring to ethics education? And what are the implications for ethics education if we take a broader perspective? Now, why do we need a global perspective? I think there are two answers. One is we are confronted with a different type of problems nowadays, not only in general, but specifically also in healthcare and in medicine. And we are confronted with what we call global problems that go beyond the individual perspective and especially are related to social and environmental issues. So that is why some people say, well, we need also in ethics an approach that not only focuses on individual benefits, what is good for individual human beings, but what is good for humanity as a whole, which is a different and broader perspective. And that's the second answer also is to this question. We need a broader ethical perspective. We need to have a more encompassing approach that goes beyond individual concerns that are the primary concern usually of medical ethics education. It's the patient and the physician, and why we tend to forget that they both work in a context and exist in a context that is much broader. Now, what are the type of problems we are confronted with today? And you know probably the name of Van Rensselaer Potter. He was the person who coined the term bioethics in the 1970s. And he was an oncology researcher, probably from Dutch ancestry. And he argued that we need a different approach in medical ethics, broader approach, therefore the new name, because we have six priority problems in medicine. And that was in 1970. And he used the trick of all starting them with a P. So the six P's of Potter. And the first is peace. Now, peace is not a problem. It's the lack of peace that is a problem. We have wars. We have violence. In his time, the Vietnam War. Also pollution. He was, in the early 70s, confronted with a lot of environmental pollution. Oil tankers that were shipwrecked, polluting the beaches in some places on the earth. So he thought that pollution is a very big problem, also for healthcare. Then poverty. Because if you have people who cannot afford health insurance, who cannot pay for medication, you have the best technology available, but that simply cannot be applied. Also population. And he has the conviction that maybe there are too many people for the globe. So there's overpopulation, need of starvation, and all those kind of issues that were important for him. Politics is also a big problem. Why? Politics is only thinking in the short term. They never think in the longer term. They want to be re-elected politicians in 4 years, so they don't take unpopular measures that have an effect in the longer run. If you want to address poverty, environmental degradation, you need to have longer term policies. And that's the problem with politics. So we have populist clowns that promise everything, but they don't solve any fundamental problem. Then also the idea of progress is a problem. And that is, you must remember, Potter was living in the United States, and the ideology of progress is one of the basic ideologies of the United States. Tomorrow will always be better than today. We will always progress. And he saw that is a problem, because we cannot be sure that tomorrow will be better. Maybe it goes the other way around. And the human race, the humanity, is at the brink of extinction if we don't solve any of these priority problems. Now, that was in 1970, Potter's six P's. If you look at today, and we look at the literature of bioethics and the discussions about global bioethics, we notice that we are confronted with more or less the same problems. We have the problem of, let's say, the problem of war and violence. Even today, it has never been away. So, and there's hardly any reflection on the ethical implications of war and violence. Hospitals are systematically destroyed, doctors are targeted, ambulances are destroyed, so the healthcare system is completely disrupted. And what about all the people who are refugees and are in different conditions? They present a massive health challenge for today and for the future. Then also, pollution is now much broader as environmental degradation and climate change. Poverty is still the same problem as it was 50 years ago. Then population, they say, well, maybe more concerns about hunger and malnutrition. Hunger and malnutrition are growing since the COVID pandemic. There is an increasing number of hungry and malnourished people. And we have the problem of migration. So rather than overpopulation in Potter's time, maybe we have significant problems with populations today. Also important for ethics activities. Then politics. And you say, well, we have a problem with governments. Is there any effective policy, any effective governance system, not only nationally, not only regionally, not only internationally? That's a big question. How did we do with the COVID pandemic? And I think the records of governments with the COVID pandemic is very poor in almost all countries. Not to speak about regional governments and international global governments. There also is a massive problem of corruption in all countries. Let's say you talk about research integrity, but integrity has been a problem in many countries for a long time because of fundamental corruption in the system. Not only in the general system, but also in healthcare. Then there is also this idea of nationalism, ethno-nationalism, which also makes it more difficult to develop global policies to address the global problems. And then finally, we are, like in Potter's time, we are convinced that economic growth and improvement and development are really not substantial. They are mythical ideas, promises that have not been substantiated. And then, of course, today we all have a problem, a new problem, that was not included in Potter's list, because at his time they thought, at least we have solved the global problem of diseases, infectious diseases. They were convinced that that problem was solved. And now we know today that it's still there. So we have important global problems. They exist already for a long time, and we have difficulties in addressing these problems, but they still have a major impact on healthcare, medicine globally, but also, therefore, they should be on the agenda of ethics. Now, we need a broader approach that going beyond the perspective of individual challenges, placing the challenges of the individual in a social and environmental context, so that we have a bioethical discourse that is more connective of different dimensions of human existence. If you look at individual treatment and care, for example, as we do in clinical ethics education, we should be aware that those issues are connected at least to social and economic conditions, access to care, which is very different in different countries, even in the States, and then the conditions of living and working. And I was teaching in the US, we had a course with a neonatologist, and he was explaining to students that he could heal children with the most sophisticated equipment in a neonatal intensive care. And then when they had a successful treatment, the child was going back to the parents. But the parents were living in a slum. They had no health insurance. They hardly could afford good food. They could not afford medication. And he said, well, he was asking, why am I doing this? I'm isolating the individual from his or her context, and I do not care about the context. I declare that the child is healed, send it back home. But I should care about the context also. And that's a big change nowadays, at least in the States, among pediatricians, that they should also explore the socioeconomic condition of the patient. Are the parents poor? Can they afford medication? Can they afford sufficient care at home? And if not, he should take care assistance is provided to the parents, so that you not only focus on one specific time of discharging the patient from the hospital, but you need to have a longer term perspective. And that means that you should address a number of broader issues, such as poverty, environmental circumstances, etc. And you have noticed in the literature that there is much more engagement now of doctors with those environmental issues. And a famous story, a case that we always use in our teaching also, is the water in Flint, Michigan, where there was an excellent water system for Michigan. Flint is one of the poorest cities in the US with a mixed population. They had a good water supply, but for economic reasons, the government of the city decided to disconnect the water system and to use the water from the river. And the river was polluted, the pipes for the water were corroded, so there was a growing number of infants with lead poisoning. And the government did nothing until the pediatricians went public. They mobilized public opinion, and they said, well, something should happen. We can treat the children for lead poisoning, but they will be handicapped for the rest of their life, and we can prevent it by changing the water supply. And that's what they did. So you see there's a kind of broader role of doctors if they really want to address this kind of problems. Now, there is, in fact, a broader framework of ethics. Well, many people say, well, these are enormous problems. How do we address them? We have many different countries, many different opinions and ethical points of view. But there is a global framework that has been accepted by all countries in the world. So you can argue that the UNESCO Declaration on Bioethics is listing a number of principles that have been agreed upon by all countries and unanimously adopted in 2005. Countries like North Korea. I never know about ethics activity in North Korea, but they have adopted this set of principles, like all the other countries. So if you then want to start ethics activities in a country, the government cannot argue that it's not possible because it's too specific. You say, no, you have agreed upon this list of principles. tell us how we can apply them and put them in practice. And that's what organizations, international organizations such as UNESCO, have been doing. Now, you see, notice that this list of principles is going from an individual to a community, to a social, and to a world perspective. It's not only autonomy. It's not only the Georgetown principles that are important, but it has been expanded into a broader set of principles, which also raises a lot of, issues regarding methodology. How do you apply it? But I would argue, first of all, it presents a number of perspectives that we should engage when we have to do with ethical issues. It is also important that the same countries have agreed on the need and the importance of ethics education. This is one of the articles in the Declaration that emphasizes that there should be promotion of ethics education at all levels. State have assumed a responsibility here. So then in UNESCO, when we wanted to set up ethics teaching programs in developing countries, then the countries cannot obstruct it. They cannot say no, because they have already declared that it's important. They can not promote it, like they do in North Korea or in other countries. They're not interested. But in most other countries, they have an interest in developing ethics teaching education programs at different levels. And that's what UNESCO has been doing. They have developed a kind of model course in bioethics based on the principles of the Declaration. They have started training courses for teachers in ethics, and they have the opportunity to establish UNESCO chairs in different countries that can promote ethics education. If you want to know more, go to the website of UNESCO and you'll find the materials there. They also have created and helped to create global platforms, like you are doing in the area of research ethics. So, well, there are now international associations, there are journals for ethics education in a broad sense. Not only bioethics, but ethics teaching in all disciplines, in fact, like engineering, environmental ethics, philosophical ethics. So there is also a database on the UNESCO website with information about ethics programs and ethics experts in different countries. And especially when you are interested in looking for colleagues to cooperate in, for example, West Africa or Islamic countries, you can find information on this website. Now, what can a global perspective contribute to ethics? You can see, you understand that it's expanding the domain of mainstream ethics beyond individual focus, beyond the emphasis on rationalism, and beyond the emphasis on technology and science. And that is because the word global here has two different aspects. And that was already clarified by Potter. Global means, on the one hand, worldwide. That's usually when we talk about globalization. But it also has the implication of being broader, inclusive, encompassing. So it is referring to a different type of problems because of globalization, worldwide problems that can only be addressed by the community of countries, not by individuals. And it refers to the importance of having different ethical perspectives. There is not one dominant ethical approach, but if you look at the list of principles, it has different type of perspectives in its approach. You can still argue that the core notion of global ethics is relationality, and that's expressed in what some people also argue that is the hallmark of today, is connectivity. People are related to each other. So there is a perspective that you have a kind of ethical horizon that assumes that we are connected. We are, of course, in autonomous individuals, but first of all, we are connected to each other. It's not autonomy, it's related autonomy. We're always related to each other. And maybe vulnerability in many cases is more important than self-determination. We have social and also individual responsibility. We need cooperation rather than competition. We need a common good instead of individual preferences, and we need collective action. So these are all important ethical characteristics for a change in perspective, a change in horizon of ethics, so that we can also clarify problems that we are confronted with in a different way. Now, what does it mean for ethics education? And I have four implications. One is ethics education should focus on the priority problems. Of course, it is important to focus on individual problems, but in most of the ethical approaches, there is too much concern with very exceptional and rare cases. And that's what I've called bizarre bioethics. I took the example of Charlie Gard, a baby of in the UK a few years ago. He had an exceptional genetic disease, which was diagnosed only in 34 other cases until that time in the world. And that case attracted CNN, BBC, reactions of President Trump, and you name it. So as if this was a very important ethical issue. And there was no talk about the fact that every day thousands of children are dying from starvation, not from a rare disease. So it's a kind of bias in the public attention going to ethical problems, raising the question, who in fact determines the agenda of the bioethical debate? And I think we should make students aware that these are very exceptional cases. Maybe we can learn something from it. But in fact, in reality, there are more pervasive problems. Pervasive problems that they notice themselves. They all know about poverty, war, environmental issues, etc. So in this perspective, we should make clear that problems are connected. And we see that especially also in the emergence of the term global health. Now, the second thing which is important for ethics education, in my view, is that education depends on the imagination. And it is already mentioned in some of the presentations before. We need to imagine things that can happen. We need to imagine what we will do when we were in his or her place. So we need to cultivate this faculty of the imagination. And imaginary visions are important because they enlarge our horizon. It's kind of what usually is called in ethics the moral point of view, but it also creates possibilities for action. And we have two philosophers here that are important, John Dewey and Gaston Bachelard. The third thing is, and that relates to the imagination, is the imagination allows us to go beyond the empirical reality. Empirical data are important, but in ethics we need to go beyond the empirical reality. We need to create and imagine opportunities to make a better world, to improve the situation as it is now. And that idea of going beyond the empirical setting is what is usually called transcendence, is important also for ethical education. How can we inspire people to think beyond the current conditions? And you see here several philosophers who have emphasized the same point. And it's important for global bioethics because we are continuously confronted with situations of injustice, cruelty, horror, indignity. And then the question is, how can we cope with all these horrors of every day? And that's the question also raised by Mikhail Ignatieff in his book on consolation. How can we preserve hope that we can improve the situation even if it's worse today? And I think that's the main issue, also the driving force of ethical debate. How can we go beyond the current situation and still hope that the future will improve and be better? Now, finally, that is the fourth issue, in ethics education, I think there is a clear connection between ethics and civilization. And that's what I like about the presentation of civil education, that you say, well, ethics is the expression of the values of civilization. And that's because ethics is not only a theoretical discourse of an individual affair, but it's a lifelong project, a way of life. And that is shared with other people. And it's also a social enterprise. We cannot do ethics on our own. We need ethics because we want to live together and improve our living conditions. And here you see that the idea is expressed, for example, by Albert Schweitzer. He said, well, the essential nature of civilization is not technology, not material resources, but it's the ideals that people keep up in improving their situation and their let's say, the conditions of humanity as a whole. And that is also expressed by Potter. The question is, what kind of an environment can we create that is most helpful to improve the world? And that is the, let's say, the inspiration of civilization. But of course, there are conditions that some of you have also mentioned. There are some conditions to allow ethical debate. You need to have openness, transparency, public deliberation, an active civil society, and a sphere of tolerance. And that's what makes ethics dependent on the political organization of society. That's why autocratic regimes don't like ethics. And in conclusion, a global approach is necessary because we have new problems and the need for a broader ethical framework. Education in ethics should focus on the priority problems, cultivate a moral imagination, go beyond the empirical setting, and be connected with human civilization. And therefore, you say, if global bioethics is imaginative, it produces images of a better world, and it has transformative power. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you so much. I would like to suggest that you can ask questions after the closing of this session, because I would like to close it because Mariette can prepare herself on her inaugural lecture. So I would like to, I think also on behalf of Mariette, I would like to say thank you to all the speakers. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being at home. I think maybe at the next slide there is. So you asked me to show this, Mariette. So if you want to know more or want to join. So the inaugural lecture is at 3:45 and from 3:30, the aula in the main building is open. So we hope to see you all there. And then the last thing I have to do is to, sorry? Oh, sorry, present. Where are you, Patricia? Sorry, Henk. I'm a little bit in a hurry then. Yeah. I thought, okay, I have to close it. So then the last thing I have to do is give the surprise to Henk. Yeah, here it is. So thank you for your talk. Yeah, thank you for being here. And then the very last thing I have to do is to wish you all luck for in 1 hour. So thank you, good luck, and see you there.